So we'd like to give the audience an option or a request that you ask questions of the both of the speakers. I think what I'll do while people are thinking of questions, I'll ask one question, which has always made me curious. The classic indications for surgical intervention on the aortic valve, we still rely on adult data. We still rely on the ACC guidelines, which is, I think, the average age for those patients is well into their 60s. And there's very, very little data in 40-year-olds, much less under that. What about quality of life as an indicator? How much does the presence of severe AI impede the quality of life of young patients? Do we restrict their activity? How do we generally approach the management of patients while we think that there's no classic indications, but is there an in-between? Are we keeping kids who should be pretty active in their, you know, in their teen years, are we keeping them in a sedentary life because of this?
Thank you, Pedro. I think that I alluded to that a little bit when I talked about the life expectancy and how long pediatric patients, how many decades of life they have ahead of them. I'm not aware about data about quality of life, but I can tell you that there is no scientific evidence in the literature that justifies restrictions from activities. This can lead to not only reduction in quality of life, but potentially for ill health from having those patients not being engaged in an active, healthy lifestyle. So I think that we, as cardiologists and surgeons, need to take these considerations into account when we think about our pediatric patients with aortic regurgitation in terms of how long do we delay or kick the ball down the road.
Yes, please.
In our institution, we've been starting to use PTFE, a reconstruction of the pulmonary valve. I've had difficulty with other places where we put pericardium of becoming calcified or aneurysmal or something else. I was wondering if you had any thoughts about the use of pericardium for the long haul and if you would consider PTFE.
Interesting question. In fact, it's something I think I brought up to Pedro about a week ago, the use of PTFE. Somebody was visiting us, and I think there are concerns that the long-term use of PTFE will be just as have been seen in the pulmonary position. And so we don't have any experience using PTFE, and I don't think we're too optimistic about it. I think with regards to pericardium, there are a number of questions we have about it it ranges from the timing of glutaraldehyde fixation, the use of glutaraldehyde fixation, if any at all. We have certainly shortened the amount of time we fixate the autologous pericardium with glutaraldehyde, so it's in the couple of minute range now. I think there are other options. We've used PhotoFix pericardium, which at least in the early results of other studies show less calcification. So we're concerned about it. I don't think we have any solid answers yet. I think it's important to take away from Ozaki's experience. Most of his is more than 85%, I think, is autologous pericardium in older patients, including those with renal failure. They haven't had a lot of reoperations for calcified aortic stenosis. So I don't know, Pedro, if you have anything to add, but
No, I think you answered it. I think we're going to alternate the three microphones. Vijay?
Yeah. I enjoyed your presentations. Nice clarity in your video. The thing is, how do you measure the length and breadth of the, you know, your each leaflets? And you said fixing a commissure is the critical step in your entire operation. Do you give some technical tips?
Yeah. Unfortunately, measuring the annulus was cut out of the video when we. But there's a sizer there that specifically, when you stretch the root, and let's just take a typical three leaflet, the three commissural valve. The sizer you put from commissure to commissure. So that is the way you measure it, at least in Professor Ozaki's initial experience. I also think we can make the measurement on echocardiogram preoperatively, and we've done that, and we're actually going to try to correlate that just by measuring the diameter of the aortic root. Okay. So to answer your first question, the sizer from commissure to commissure, and you stretch out the root. So that's how you make the measurement.
And commissure, how do you said that's a critical step in the entire operation. So do you have any technical tips?
Yeah, I think the critical step is just getting the maneuver down. And the second to last stitch, and maybe we can go over it offline, but the second to last stitch, you take a deep bite. Because when you take a deep bite, it everts the commissure in, it brings it together, and it allows better coaptation. So there are a couple of important technical details about it.
Thank you.
I would like to come back to the history of the indication and maybe a comment about the left ventricular function, because we are extrapolating data from primary aortic regurgitation, but this disease is quite rare in children. Most of these patients were born with aortic stenosis, so the ventricle is something different from electrical irritability and maybe stiffness, and some of those patients couldn't end up even with pulmonary hypertension. So you have a long history, long experience about treatment of those patients. I would like that you comment a little bit this point.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. This is, our patients are, while we do see some patients with primary aortic regurgitation, many of our patients have either mixed aortic valve disease and associated anomalies, mostly of the left side of the heart. So your point is very well taken. Diastolic function is a major issue in these patients, and in fact, in some patients, it's the deciding factor in terms of referral for surgery in order to take away the volume load and move them along the pressure-volume curve. So these are all relevant and important observations that highlight how much are how big is the challenge in terms of deciding when to do surgery in a child with aortic valve disease.
AK?
A question for both of you. Have you explored different fixative solutions for pericardium other than glutaraldehyde? Because 2 years, we haven't seen calcification, but downstream, that's going to happen in these growing children. So are you exploring the possibility of using other fixative solutions that may not encourage calcification as much with glutaraldehyde? I'll have you answer that and then just...
Well, I mean, PhotoFix fixation doesn't use glutaraldehyde. It uses light fixation. So we are using other types of pericardium that don't use glutaraldehyde. And the question is, do we even need any glutaraldehyde? So just use unfixed autologous pericardium. And there are some European data out there that suggest aortic valve repair with unfixed pericardium is probably as good as fixed pericardium. So we are trying to compare those. And in our early experience, there's no difference, but it's too early to tell.
And my question to Tal is, the adaptive response to chronic ventricular volume overload in children, newborns, infants, older children, is probably different from adults substantially. And we just see, they seem to tolerate volume overload much more easily. You've got other models, you know, moderate VSTs that exist for a long time, big ventricles, Z-scores are in the same range, and they seem to do quite well. We don't understand this entity really well, isn't it?
No, we don't understand it, although I would just perhaps suggest a word of caution. And it used to be an assumption in our fields that patients that have small to moderate VSDs but no no pulmonary hypertension can tolerate that quite well, and they dilate. And if you look at Welton-Gersony's data from Colombia that followed a cohort of such patients over a long time, they ended up faring not so well. So it's, again, it's true, and I would agree with everybody, anybody who says that this that extrapolating from adults to children in aortic valve disease is not the right thing to do. It's just that it's the best data that we currently have. The situation in children is clearly much more complex, including the pathophysiology. But nonetheless, I am not convinced that that this is an innocent circumstance, even when children seem to be asymptomatic and quote-unquote do okay.
We struggle a great deal with these symptomless patients with regurgitation, and it's, you were very clear about the criteria that you think we use are very much based on echocardiographic dimension and ventricular ejection fraction. But we look at reversal of flow in the aorta. We look at the color images of how wide, how deep the flare of regurgitation is, and whether it's eccentric or central or not. We look at MRI, looking at regurgitant fractions of aortic regurgitation. But do you think all these are, we should put to one side? Do you think we should stick to really clear echocardiographic criteria? Often it's very difficult not to be influenced by these other things.
Not necessarily. I think that in some that has to be tailored to the individual patients, and there are some patients in whom echo just does an excellent job, and you get all the information that you need. I will not repeat all of the advantages of echocardiography. However, when the data is not as clear, when there's discrepancy between echocardiographic study to study, or between the clinical data and echocardiographic data, between ECG and echo, and so on. When there's the data is not as clear, we would often use MRI as an arbiter, especially when there is a question of surgical intervention.
What about catheterization? I mean, I you know, the role of catheterization in these patients, I think, isn't always clear, and there is a subset that has a relatively big defect in the valve, small regurgitant volume, but in great part due to a very non-compliant left ventricle. And these are the patients that I think Lorenzo pointed out are born with severe or critical aortic stenosis and have that persist for a while and then later develop aortic regurgitation. When do you cath these patients?
So. Well, even the adults struggle with that, so let alone in children. And I think that we actually have a relatively low threshold to catheterize patients when the clinical data and the imaging data is not absolutely consistent, or when we are concerned about non-compliance and high LVEDP. The question then becomes, what do we do with that data, and how does it affect our management? And that's the answer to that is not clear, at least not in my mind. But nonetheless, I think that because the decision to intervene is not in, is consequential, we try to get as much data as possible, and hemodynamic data by catheterization is sometimes necessary and helpful.
Our institution is involved with European multicentric clinical trial with a decellularized homograft. And 86 or 87 homograft have already been implanted. So what's your opinion as to this other alternative as compared to Ozaki procedure or something else?
That's in the aortic position.
Aortic position, yes.
So, I mean, in our institution, we use very few aortic homographs, so we limit that.
But really, decellularized, I'm talking about completely
right.
Treated, decellularized, then implanted.
Right. Yeah. So in general, we use very few aortic homographs in the aortic position to start with. So our experience is pretty limited. I guess what you're trying to get at is the calcification. potential, and theoretically, it should be less.
I think that there are two ways you can implant a decellularized homograft. As part of a Ross operation, and put the homograft in the pulmonary position, and I think there's no question that having decellularized reduces the antigenicity. Putting the homograft decellularized in the aortic position, however, I think there's pretty good evidence that the decellularization process, all the detergents that go into getting rid of the glycosaminoglycans, reduces the strength, the integral strength of that homograft, of the wall, of the leaflet wall. And so how they will hold up under systemic pressures, I think is still a question mark. So I think there is a need for a study, and that's being conducted. So I'd be very curious about that data. But personally, I would worry about using a decellularized homograft in a systemic AV valve.
Well, we'll see. You know, the trial just started, and, you know, Hanover, the University of Hanover, is the primary investigator. There are six centers around Europe, and we'll see how it goes. You know, but I just wanted to know your opinion, but you seem to be a little bit skeptical about it.
In the systemic position. I think the pulmonary, I think it's unquestionably a good idea.
Thank you.
One brief question. Sorry. Go ahead.
Just 3 weeks ago in Ottawa, it was a landmark meeting about aortic valve repair. Professor Ozaki was not there, but one of your colleagues presented an amazing experience with autologous pericardium in a similar type of repair without a template with 10-year follow-up, extremely good results. And he also presented experimental data that autologous pericardium holding ice bath remains viable. Have you used autologous pericardium that is ice cold?
I mean, not treated with glucose.
Not treated.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, we've used, we don't have a head-to-head comparison. I don't think we have long-term data, but we have used non-treated pericardium. I think early on in the experience, before the Ozaki experience, and I think we have a publication out there on the technique of using three leaflet extension with pericardium in much the same way you're describing. And I think the difference is with the Ozaki technique, it's important to remove all the leaflet and the base of the leaflet. When you just use the extensions and don't use the template, the base of the leaflet tends to not move as well. So what I suspect will happen is, and we've seen those fail relatively soon.
Thank you.
Please help us improve the content by providing us with some feedback.